Good afternoon. For those of you who are not from the law school, my name is Dan Attridge, and I'm the dean here, and it's my pleasure to welcome all of you to our event today. Our special guest to our right is Mr. Robert J. Stevens. Mr. Stevens is the retired chairman, president, and CEO of Lockheed Martin Corporation. Prior to those positions, he held a variety of executive positions at the corporation, including chief operating officer, chief financial officer, head of strategic planning, through a career that involved him in various management, finance, manufacturing, and operational responsibilities. He currently is the lead director for Monsanto Company, and he's a member of the board of directors of United States Steel Corporation, the Congressional Medal of Honor Foundation, the Marine Corps Scholarship Foundation, and the Atlantic Council. He is a fellow of the American Astronautical Society, the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics, the Royal Aeronautical Society, and the International Academy of Astronautics, and he's a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. In 2001, Mr. Stevens served on President George W. Bush's commission to examine the future of the United States aerospace industry, and in January 2012, he was appointed by President Barack Obama to the Advisory Committee for Trade Policy and Negotiations, and he currently serves as the chair of the Director of the National Intelligence Senior Advisory Group. Without further getting into his background, I just want to say we're quite fortunate that Mr. Stevens is willing to share his expertise and his thoughts with us. And please join me in welcoming Mr. Stevens to Catholic University and our law school.
Thank you.
So at Mr. Stevens' suggestion, the format we'll be using this afternoon is an informal conversation rather than a more formal lecture. Mr. Stevens has invited me to act as his interviewer, and I will be posing questions on your behalf on a range of topics that I hope is of interest to you. As time permits, Mr. Stevens would be happy to take questions from the audience after I complete my questioning. So let's get started. As I indicated, Mr. Stevens, you're the former chairman, president, CEO of Lockheed Martin Corporation, certainly one of the most important companies in the world. And you've enjoyed great success in your career and perhaps even suffered an occasional disappointment. So I wanted to ask you, first of all, what is your proudest achievement in your distinguished career at Lockheed? If you can limit it to one thing.
Yeah, we can try. First, thanks for the warm welcome. It's nice to be with you all today. It's particularly nice to be in front of aspiring attorneys in a courtroom where I'm not the object of the proceeding today, so it is nice to be with you. I think as you look forward in your careers, you should expect to find yourself in a leadership capacity, and irrespective of the things you might bring with you that you want to get done, you'll be confronted with a set of circumstances that exist when you get there. And for me, that set of circumstances was defined by the end of a period of consolidation in the aerospace industry where 22 companies were put together very rapidly to form what is today Lockheed Martin. So one of the principal responsibilities I've had, and one of the things I'm very proud of, is to have worked with an exceptional emerging leadership team to restructure the company, to integrate all those pieces, and importantly, to form a culture of an organization that we thought rose to the demands of the moment we found ourselves in. And the foundations of that culture, while it is a company built on engineering excellence, really were unimpeachable integrity in everything that we do. And that foundation exists today, so it long survived me. So I think a very satisfying accomplishment was to see a leadership team emerge, understand the demands, put the pieces together, support the customers, and still build the company on a very solid ethical foundation.
Okay, let's talk about the flip side, a disappointment that you encountered in terms of the biggest challenge you had, and maybe it didn't turn out the way you wanted, but how did you address it? Would you have done it differently?
We only have an hour. there's a long list of things that didn't go well. I think on the challenge side, maybe it's the flip side of that coin I highlighted. At one time, we had 175,000 employees. When you find yourself in that leadership role, you'll find that it's not optional. In other words, you got to be the leader every day, and you'll be amazed at how carefully people watch you as a leader. So there is real teeth to the notion of tone at the top, and I wanted to assure that we were communicating effectively with this large number of individuals. So getting out of the office, getting around to the individuals in the enterprise and talking about the values that we shared together was a huge challenge, because there's a lot of crowding out in the information channels, and I found that to be particularly demanding. I will tell you honestly, if you're maintaining a very solid foundation of solid ethics and values in business conduct, the other things honestly don't seem to matter that much. I mean, a failure in business is not, I've acquired companies that I thought we would do very well in owning. They didn't. Mm-hmm. So we underperformed financial expectations, or we weren't able to deliver on a set of commitments we made to customers because the engineering or the physics proved particularly difficult. You work your way through those problems. The biggest challenges were not to have any escapes relative to our ethics and integrity. If you give me 30 seconds, I'll give you probably one of the most poignant experiences I had. As a newly minted CEO in my first trip to Japan, I was sitting in an interview not terribly unlike this, although there were TV cameras. And the very first question from the interviewer was and this is through a translator, which we can talk about the mechanics and artfulness of working through translators when you work internationally. How does it feel to be the newly minted CEO of the company that 30 years ago brought down the Japanese government in a bribery scandal? Welcome, thank you. It's very nice to be here with you. And the answer I offered wasn't obviously one that was scripted. It was, we spent a lot of time in a company talking about ethics and integrity and wondering what the half-life of a violation is. And you've just helped me understand it's more than 30 years. That's a stain you can't wash off. So you can survive a bad quarter. You can survive an underperforming technology. But if you sacrifice your integrity, if you sacrifice your character, that stays with you and probably the people who come into the enterprise after you, by my measure, at least 3 decades. I would ask you to avoid that.
Okay. I want to come back to some ethics issues, but picking up on Japan and world leaders, certainly you've encountered your share of world and business leaders, and I wonder if you might name one or two notables and give you your thoughts.
There have been a lot over the last 20 years, but the most memorable, I think, are the people who surprised me the most. I'll give you one dated example and one current example. I had the occasion to have dinner with Mikhail Gorbachev, who at one time was the General Secretary of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, and I guess I spent most of my adult life trying to assure that they didn't reach their aspirational goals. And the occasion was our government asked our company to be involved after the fall of the Berlin Wall and the dissolution of the Soviet Union to help Russian industry. And we bought a rocket motor from a company called NPO and Nergamosh and put it into our Atlas vehicle, and we're launching commercial satellites with it. And I was visiting with President Gorbachev and asked him if he thought there was any irony there that a Russian motor would be on a U.S. rocket launching satellites. And he had such good humor in that conversation. But what impressed me was when he spoke about Ronald Reagan, the true affection he had for Reagan. And I'm guessing not many of you were around in those days, but if I was to characterize the rhetoric, it was a frightening time. Ronald Reagan was not a very conciliatory president, and there was an existential threat of a nuclear exchange with the Russians. And yet, I'm sitting across the table from a person who found a counterpart with whom he had genuine affection, a genuine bond. And it reminded me that you can find that in people no matter what the differences are, because these folks would be such extraordinary poles on a continuum, yet they found a way, and through their interaction, they really did make the world a safer and, I believe, better place. In a more contemporary example, I've met and worked with a gentleman in the Middle East named Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed Al Nahyan. And if you think of him on the surface, he's a Muslim, a Sunni. He's a monarch in the Alnayan family. He's an Arab. And you might, those names might conjure up some sense about who he is. But after working with him for more than 15 years, he is one of the most thoughtful, most erudite, most compelling global leaders I believe I've known, who has great insight into the region. In fact, I wish we would have listened a little bit more to some of his suggested courses of action. And what's memorable about my conversation with him early on, I think it was maybe 2007, when President Obama was then candidate and Senator Obama, he told me what a marvelous country America would be if a black man could run for president and get elected. And he then, without attempting to give me a tutorial, talked about the first Emancipation Proclamation and the second Emancipation Proclamation and Abraham Lincoln's activities of 145 years ago. And in such a very short period of time, only 145 years, this black man could become president of the United States. And I must tell you, I felt smallish in his presence because I didn't know that history about the Emancipation Proclamations. I ventured not a lot of Americans did. But the useful aspect of that for me is we criticize our country a lot, and probably appropriately in many ways because we set high standards. But through the eyes of those in the rest of the world, this is a great country. And I think we ought to think about its greatness every now and then and set higher aspirational goals and try to achieve those rather than criticizing every little part of what we do to encourage us to reach the kinds of aspirational heights that Sheikh Mohammed would have for us. So those are two. There have been many more. A footnote, I met with twin brothers in Poland. One was the president, one was the prime minister. Ask them to wear different ties or something because this can really get to be a confusing day when you're meeting twin brothers who have different jobs in the government.
Okay. I appreciate the history lesson. I think a number of our audience members are a little bit younger than perhaps we are, and I'm not sure they're familiar with the comment that President Reagan, when he went to Germany, made about Gorbachev and the wall.
Well,
you might
sure.
Remind them of that.
Of course, Ronald Reagan was elected to become a hardliner and an anti-communist, and he would routinely call that entire enterprise the evil empire. I don't think that's the kind of overture that allows the other side to embrace your thinking. So we started at fairly distant points on this conversation. They had negotiations and discussions in places like Reykjavik that ended in really a sad and insubstantial set of conclusions because Reagan would not give an inch on a Star Wars missile defense. I mean, the history here is really ripe and worthy of a read. I know you've got a lot of other reading to do, but if you ever have the time, it's worthy of a read. But I highlight it because you couldn't almost envision greater polar opposites who could come to a center and find a better path. And I will tell you through the eyes of Gorbachev, true affection for his counterpart in the United States, and a great affection for America, which he went on and on and on to talk about the marvels of our country. So I always try to think of those examples as well as trying to deal with all the problems of the moment. This is a pretty great experiment that we have here, and we ought to invest ourselves in seeing that it has a bright future.
Okay. Let me turn to a couple of Lockheed's business areas. Obviously, aerospace and defense are things that virtually everyone would know about Lockheed. And I just wanted to ask you, now that you're the retired chairman, president, and CEO, maybe you can step back and reflect a little bit. Could you give us some of your thoughts about the future of those areas, what kind of developments we ought to be expecting as members of the public that Lockheed is serving?
I always like to start an answer to a question such as this is reminding everybody it was fine when I left. It is a very complex company, very steeped in advanced engineering. I don't think the character will change very much with respect to aeronautics and astronautics and those kinds of things. You know, we just had information, for example, about the prospect of water on Mars. Our company built the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter that helps to determine those things. This is very exciting science to look out into the universe and perhaps understand a little bit more about the quality of our planet and how the we should shape a path forward. I will tell you, I guess have a fear today that the world's experiencing greater levels of instability and uncertainty. There are about 190 countries. More than half of them are showing some signs of economic, political, or social instability. That number has been growing. That's not a good long-term trend, not only for our security, but the security of the planet. We think in terms of how we can help our customers avoid the consequence of war. Very often I've met with groups who have, through their judgment, suggested that we add to these levels of stress in the world because of the security work that we do. I will tell you, I certainly don't look at it that way, nor do my colleagues. But we really would like to see a world that is less quick to use military action and exercise the major muscle groups that we have in the company to do more exploratory work. Mm-hmm. But I do think we're going to be in for a period of challenge. Certainly in your lifetimes, you'll need to confront these challenges. And we've mentioned international travel. I think these are great ways to get involved, lean forward, understand our counterparts around the world, and see if we can cultivate pathways that don't lead to the kind of armed conflict that we're likely to see for a while.
So you mentioned Mars. People probably noticed that in the news earlier this week. Do you think that there will be life on Mars? Either that we'll find there or that we'll go to?
There have been occasions where I thought I might have already met. I don't think it'll be life as we know it, as we define it. Mm-hmm. There are interesting preconditions. It's not just Mars. You know, if you turn it around, and I've spent a lot of time with a lot of different kinds of scientists, they will tell you about the trillions of stars that have hundreds of trillions of galaxies. So it is intriguing with respect to just the laws of large numbers. Will we find something out there that looks someday like it will be, something as to life as we'd recognize it? But there's no indication of that yet. I wouldn't drink the water there just quite yet. Yeah.
Okay. How about Mars as a potential place as a colony?
Love to go there. I'd love to go there myself. I'd love to see us explore these opportunities more. It's very interesting as a nation. We're the first humans to go to another planet. I had the good fortune in my life of knowing as a personal friend Neil Armstrong, mm-hmm. which is just one, go figure. And who never wanted to talk about going to the moon, by the way. You will not, sadly he's passed now, but you would not have met a more humble human being when asked about what's it like to be the first person on the moon. He would routinely say there were 3,500 people involved in getting the spacecraft to the moon. I was one of them. Mm-hmm. And not take the question any further. Just a remarkable guy. Yeah, I'd like to see us doing more of that kind of exploration. Yeah, but we walked away from that program. I mean, the zenith, the absolute height of exploration, and as a nation didn't return to it, I don't think that's a good habit to develop.
Mm-hmm. Let me switch business sectors over to information technology, another one of Lockheed's areas, and focus on cybersecurity for a moment. Obviously the Chinese president was here last week, and there was much talk about an agreement about no more hacking. I don't think it was quite that broad, but that was certainly the subject of it. Let me just ask you sort of broadly about cybersecurity. What do you think some of the biggest threats that we're facing? How should we address them? At the same time we're addressing them, how do we protect our civil liberties, against the threats to our security? Could you comment on that?
That's a big question. Cyber will continue to be one of the greatest challenges we all face and you all face. And actually, I think we're just at the infancy. If you sort of look back historically and think of the agricultural revolution and how long that took, and then the industrial revolution, and then the information revolution, and add three ingredients, the speed and capacity of processing power with algorithms, just software. We crunch a lot of numbers really fast in today's computers. The storage capacity that we have, which is huge in digitized data, and then networks that connect it all together. We've created the kind of infrastructure here nobody's ever seen before. It has great advantages, like most kinds of scientific discovery or engineering exploration, and it has huge liabilities. And one of the liabilities is, I guess you all put out information pretty routinely through social media or other mechanisms about you. I hope you know when you do that, it is in no way secure. And I'm not on it, by the way. You won't find me on Facebook or any social media because I know what you can do with the information.
We looked.
Yeah, and you won't find it.
We didn't find it.
Yeah, and so I think that this is going to be a continuing challenge, and it's probably going to have a pattern of we'll try to advance some security measure, and then smart people will figure out a countermeasure, and then we'll counter that countermeasure, because if you look at evolutions in technology, that's pretty much been the case. Sadly, the human condition is such that there are a lot of people who would resort to crime or malfeasance in some way rather than other activities, and this is a very ripe environment for that. There'll be great questions that will come to your doorstep as attorneys and as counselors. We have a former general counsel named Jim Comey. I hired Jim into the company after he left the government service as deputy attorney general. He is now back working as a director of the FBI. And we'll talk about encryption, and we'll talk about going dark on devices, for example. And the question is, would you want a device provider to create an instrument that you could never get in? In other words, in Jim Comey's framing, how would you feel in the physical world if somebody could build a house that law enforcement could never get in, even with a warrant? Because you can do that now with encryption codes for these kinds of devices, which essentially means that electronically you build a house nobody can get in. Is that a good and wise thing for law enforcement, for our society? Mm-hmm. Many of the providers of these kinds of devices say that's what our customers want, and therefore that's what we're going to give them. There'll be no encryption key, you can't get in it. And there are those in law enforcement who say we'll be creating a safe harbor where the average person probably won't have great gain from that kind of capability, but mm-hmm. if you're nefarious, it's a wonderful safe haven for your conduct. So that debate won't be answered easily or quickly, but it'll be a debate you'll probably be a part of.
Okay. So I can keep my iPhone, because you have one.
Well, only now.
Oh, okay. But I got to get off Facebook.
You know, I chair for the Director of National Intelligence, his senior advisory group, and when you go into any of the intelligence buildings, whether it's Liberty Crossing or Langley or Fort Meade, you don't ever take these even in the building. Mm-hmm. You might ask why.
Well, as I've visited some of our alums, they've told me the answer is Edward Snowden. That's
well,
why.
Should ask yourself, how do you feel about Edward Snowden? I mean, it's a very ripe topic. Ask yourselves, do you think that he did the right thing in the right way for the right reason? I have my own views, but I think that it's important that you have your views about these subjects and circumstances, because it's enveloping your lives and our lives right now.
Let's pick off another big topic, climate change. Big issue, small issue, non-issue. If it is an issue, what should we be doing about it? And what can we do about it individually? Climate change, it's a big one.
It's a huge issue. Last time I checked, notwithstanding water on Mars, we only have one planet. Probably ought to pay attention to what's happening here. The best insight I have about let me call it climate change rather than global warming, and I'll tell you why. I went to the South Pole, to the Antarctic Station with National Science Foundation team, spent a week there, where they have exquisite climate scientists. Now, the reason they told me don't call it global warming is we work in chronological time. The Earth moves in geological time. Won't get into an argument with you today about how old the planet is. Different people have different views. Most scientists think it's about 4.5 billion years old. You can go down through the ice, you can take core samples, you have pretty pristine core samples through the ice, take you back 60, 70, 80,000 years. But in a planet that is as old as our planet, that's not very much data. the one observation that was most compelling was a level of CO2 in the atmosphere that you can study it for 68,000 years and it pretty much flatlines it, not very much. And correlating well with the industrial age, it kind of starts to go up at a high rate and it continues to go up. So what can we do about it? I would really like to see more research and development spent on two segments of the science, because I think science plays a real role here. One part of the science would be, if CO2 is rising, what can we do about the CO2 that we have? Can you scrub it? Can you convert it? Can you change its form and function in a way that makes it less deleterious, or even, you know, can we make cheese out of it or something? Can we get some good byproduct from it? The other part is energy. I've been a fan of fusion power generation. It's not quite renewable, but it has attractive aspects to me. The unattractive aspects are it generates magnetic fields and pressures and temperatures that we don't have the engineering to manage yet. But with material science applications and other things, I believe someday we will, and we ought to invest ourselves in that. There's a much broader issue here. For me, the climate falls into a category where there's a handful of other things: food, water, the energy component I mentioned, climate and disease. These are not national challenges. These are planetary challenges. We have about 7.2 billion people on this planet today. If you ask scientists who are involved in sustainability efforts, how many people will this planet support in a sustainable way? Sadly, you won't get a number even close to the number of people on the planet today, which is unnerving. And by 2050, that number is going to go to 9.5 billion people, and that's not a wild guess. That is a reasonably precise extrapolation out of population growth, and these folks are going to be born into areas that can't sustain their food and water requirements. And if you say we're going to add a third to the planet's population in 35 years, that may not sound like it's a lot. Think of adding another China and almost another India to the global population in 35 years. So we're going to need international mechanisms here to deal with planetary problems. We can hardly get through the United Nations today. Mm-hmm. We don't have any brokerage function, any agency function, any ongoing dialogue with people who represent the humans on the planet as to how we're going to deal with this. And yet, if we don't, again, in your lifetime, you will see famine on a scale this planet has never seen before, because that growth in population is unprecedented. So there are real challenges about the climate, the environment, mm-hmm. the quality of life here. I believe, sadly for me, it's, again, just my opinion, the politics of the day are not up to the challenges of the day. And maybe you can go forward and help fix that too.
Is there a way forward? Do you see a path forward?
There's always a way. I mean, if Gorbachev can sit down with Reagan, there's a way forward. If Sheikh Mohammed can support the Israelis, remember, he's a Sunni Muslim Arab who lives in the neighborhood, who has no animus about living a peaceful coexistence with Israel, you can do anything. You can do what you set your mind to. It takes real leadership. Mm-hmm. It takes some compromise. It takes complete devotion of your energies. I think we're just very distracted today. We talk about the things that, you know, I don't want to talk about Inflategate anymore. I don't care if Tom Brady took air out of the balls. I really don't care. I care about feeding a billion new members of the planet over the next decade. Maybe we could devote a little more time to that.
Okay. Let me shift over to some other topics. I want to talk about compliance-related issues. Obviously,
my favorite topic.
At Lockheed and where you're director at other organizations, you've dealt with a host of compliance-related issues, and you've seen some change in compliance and corporate responsibility issues over the years, and probably toward the direction of greater scrutiny, greater oversight. So I wanted you to sort of comment on those changes, some of the pros, some of the cons, maybe where there's too much compliance, too little compliance. How do we achieve the right balance in compliance?
You're embedded in your question, Dean, is certainly the observation I have, and I think a lot of folks have, that there is more demand for compliance. I think that's appropriate, by the way. Institutions are getting a lot more complicated. We've talked about cybersecurity or the speed of communications, the interrelatedness enterprises now share on a global basis. I mean, if you don't like globalization, you're going to be in for a less than great next half century, because it's only going to continue. We're woven more and more tightly together by lots of means and mechanisms. So with big organizations, complex organizations, you need to have, I think, a very sound body of statutory and regulatory frameworks in which to operate. And the rule of law is absolutely the best way to approach this as compared to any other alternative that I've seen. I'm not a big fan of adding to the compliance regimen aspects for enterprises to follow that aren't helpful or constructive. And here's my fear: an oversaturation that dumbs down the really important things. It seems like there's almost never a sunsetting provision in many of these compliance or regulatory frameworks. So we're still doing things that were required from 150 years ago that have much less relevance today. So how a question for you is, how can we refresh that and keep it vital so that you just don't saturate the environment with compliance issues? In our company, and I rather like this a great deal, we spent as much or more time talking about ethics as compared to compliance, because compliance is the rules-based, you got to do this or you got to avoid doing that. And it typically trends toward the least amount of things you could do, right? The minimum requirement is what you have to do to be compliant. We wanted to change the discussion in the company and talk not so much about what we can't do, but who we should be and why. And is that consistent with a vision for the corporation, a strategy for the corporation, and the commitment of the people that work there? That is a richer and deeper conversation for me. I think it was for my colleagues. So we spent as much time talking about ethics and integrity and behavioral-based aspects of the culture of the company, in addition to those things we needed to do to be compliant, because as a government contractor, I assure you there's no shortage of regulations applied to the business. Sometimes when we get audited, we can't go man-to-man coverage. We got to go zone, because there are more government auditors than we have employees, and that's no kidding. I'll give you an illustration. There's a lot of talk about why people like me got paid what I got paid. And as part of that discussion that flows into income inequality, there is a regulation being promulgated now for publicly traded companies to put a pay ratio in the annual report under the compensation discussion and analysis section of the proxy response. For the life of me, I cannot figure out what that information informs about a company that would give an investor any knowledge that they don't already have about whether an investment in the enterprise is worthy of their time, effort, and risk. I understand the moral issues. I understand the subject of income inequality. We all find our ways to deal with that. Why that becomes a responsibility in a public company is beyond me. So to the extent that we don't, and the risk there is, it's just one more thing you put in that proxy statement. How many of you read a proxy statement? You're going to write them, so you should read some of them. They're awful. They are so bad. So why do you have all these disclosures and Qs and Ks and proxies? You have them because companies and people like me have an accountability to be transparent. How are we running this place? And with all these requirements, these materials are becoming volumes now. And I get calls from shareholders that they wouldn't probably want you to know about, saying, is there anything you can do to make this simpler? Can you just give me a table? Because we don't read that stuff. Well, if the very people who own the company in the democratization of shareholder rights aren't reading this because the transparency isn't enabling their investment decisions, why are we doing it? Because there's a cost, and when everything's in a requirement, then you're not focusing on the really important stuff. So I'd like to see it shaped differently, but there'll be a rich future for you all in compliance. Trust me.
Well, that's what I was going to ask. What do you see as the role for lawyers in compliance?
It's huge, because go back to the interview in Japan. Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, don't violate that, would be pretty good advice from any of you as a counsel. You know, when I first got the job, I worked for a very colorful gentleman named Norm Augustine. And Norm, in giving me some advice as to being a new CEO, at the time we had 175,000 people, he said, you know, I just want you to know there's no city of 175,000 people that doesn't have a jail. That gave me no comfort at all. And what he was telling me is, you know, we've got one. I mean, somebody kiting checks, somebody stealing money, somebody watching pornography on, yes, we're going to have one. And your job is to try to mobilize resources to stop that in this enterprise. But we're probably going to have something like that. We should all focus on getting rid of the things we have to get rid of. And I just worry that everything now starts to look like everything else. When we had Sarbanes-Oxley Section 404 process compliance issues, I sat with volumes of certifications from every supervisor in the company, because a couple of companies had an ethical lapse. Every company that's publicly traded has to go through this process. The medical equivalent is some people in our community have cancer, but everybody gets chemo. That's not a good idea. So maybe there can be a meritorious-based compliance routine. I'm all for setting the standards high for compliance, and if you violate them, make the punishment severe. Make the punishment severe. If you're a person in my position and you cook the books, you should pay a serious price for that. Because I know the difference, and so do the people in the company. Look at Volkswagen today. I have no insight into that car company. I've written a lot of software. There is no possible way this happened without people knowing that. There is no possible way. Where were they? Come forward. That's why we talk about ethics. That's why we have hotlines and safe harbors. Come forward. You're doing this enterprise a service. I'd rather have 1,000 times a person come forward and highlighting something that proved not to be so than miss the one that would be the emissions control software intended to defeat the compliance protocols. That's a horrible thing. So there's an example of why we have it.
Okay. Glad you brought up the subject of ethics, something our students are going to be studying during their years here. I want to bring up terminology that's evolving. Sometimes it's known as corporate social responsibility. It may also go by the name of sustainability. And I looked on Lockheed's website last night, probably something you don't have occasion to do any longer, but they mentioned that Lockheed has a sustainability management plan that covers six areas. I assume that some of this may have gotten started while you were there, but the areas they mention are governance, product performance, talent competitiveness, supplier sustainability, resource efficiency, and information security. I mean, it sounds like a very broad-based plan to address what are at bottom probably ethics-related issues. And I wonder if you could comment on that. I mean, that's certainly not something you would have seen on a corporate website 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, et cetera.
Mm-hmm. It all started during my tenure, and it had nothing to do with me. It actually had everything to do with young people joining the company. That's how it got started. That's how it got to my office. When people asked, do you have a sustainability program for the corporation? And my first response, and I'm not proud of this, is we're really busy. You know, we have a lot of things to do. Because I didn't understand the subject. Just footnote, you all have great ideas. You see the world differently. Find your voice, because I learned from the people who were joining the company. We call old engineers graybeards. They don't know everything. We tried to get weight out of the space shuttle early on. Taking weight out of a complex system is a very hard and very expensive thing to do. A very young engineer who probably snuck in the room, to be honest with you, asked, why do we paint the liquid fuel tank that lasts for 2 minutes that you throw back into the ocean? Because it has 900 pounds of highly toxic epoxy paint on it. What a great question. We didn't have to engineer anything. Just stop painting the tank. So raise your voice. This came up from people who asked the question, and the first pilot project was in Owego, New York, where we were throwing away garbage, and somebody read that you could take this garbage and convert it to energy. And they were right. So the light bulb goes off after, even in a person like me, after a while, that doing good and being smart are not mutually exclusive things, and the bottom line can be enhanced by some initiatives like this. So we extended that discussion to what else should we be thinking about for a more sustainable planet, a more sustainable environment in our workforce, better service to our customers. Turns out there are many, many things you can do. So we have a committee on the board of directors now that is entitled the Sustainability Committee, and that's what they look at. We issue an annual report because we think it's important. And we're not alone. I mean, I think most contemporary enterprises are doing things like that.
And you think it's consistent with good business practices?
I'm sure of it, or we wouldn't do it. You know, it would get extinguished. If it didn't find a home, if it was just lifting for the sake of lifting, mm-hmm. and wasn't advancing the interests of the enterprise. But I will say also, it was driven by a community of professionals who were new entrants to the workforce. It wasn't driven by the folks like me who had been around for decades. And I don't think we could attract the quality of employee that we seek if we weren't very conversant in sustainability initiatives and why they matter. You know, there's a corollary to this. I mean, I would sit with employees, young employees, and they would ask me about their vacation. When I started to work, I was terrified to ask if I got vacation. I mean, I was happy to have a job. And my boss came out, I worked in a factory, and he came out and he said, you got 2 weeks, we're busy, you can't take it. You know, that was the full kind of warm discussion. And they talked about work-life balance, and I thought, it was a terrible thing to say. I thought, don't you have to work before you have work-life balance? You're just out of college. What are you talking about? Turns out they wanted to know if they had 4 weeks vacation because they were volunteers, in some cases in church programs or civic programs, and they wanted to go back to South America and finish building the school. So here again, you feel about this big and say, take the four, we changed our vacation policy, right? But that didn't come from the executive office. Mm-hmm. That came from employees saying, can we have flexible work hours? We want to volunteer. Turns out the employees of Lockheed Martin volunteer well over 1 million hours a year. That's a lot. And they're doing it in, you know, there's no coercion here. And we set up an employee assistance fund that I gave money to just to get, and employees can contribute to that. Plus, we went to the board of directors and said, with this kind of interest, maybe we should have a philanthropic account for the corporation so that we can do some things at the local level where we're citizens in communities. It's very contagious, it's very smart, it's good business because we're citizens in the communities in which we live and work. So all that worked very well. I'll take credit for it because that's what CEOs do.
Or blame.
Yeah,
or blame.
Blame others and take
credit. It works yeah. Both ways. Let me ask you some questions about lawyers. You've obviously had a chance to work with any number of lawyers, both in-house lawyers and outside counsel over the years. Could you describe what you think some of the traits of the best lawyers are that you've worked with and some of the traits of the worst lawyers that you work with? You don't have to name any names. I'm just looking for the traits.
Yeah, in full disclosure, I have two sons and they're both attorneys, products of law school. I want to go back to this unimpeachable character, this integrity, this trustworthiness. There are lots of other attributes. Be fully engaged with your colleagues. Try to find solutions. Recognize you're smart people. It's hard to get into law school. This is a great law school. You'll work with engineers, or if you're in business, or people of other persuasions. They're smart people too, but they rarely speak English. I mean, so you might want to try being multilingual and learning how to communicate effectively. But what mattered most to me was knowing that the advice or the opinion or the counsel I was receiving was completely as objective as a human being could have it. It wasn't conflicted in any way. There wasn't another agenda. That the people providing that advice or making those recommendations were doing so for the best interests of the enterprise, and they were articulate in defining why that was the case. I would try to avoid some of the, you know, if you go in and talk about Van Gorkum, not a lot of people in a company are going to know what you're talking about in the legal cases that you review. So trying to translate that into English that's easy for business folks to understand is a huge attribute that's an asset.
And some of the worst traits?
You know, there are we've had attorneys who just like to recite a lot of legal mumbo jumbo and it doesn't help solve the problem at all, or they give you a long list of things that you can't do or why that's not likely to happen. That's not what people like me need. I want to get something done. Now, that doesn't mean if you think it's the craziest thing you've ever heard, don't advise me to do it. But solve the problem and find a way. And I'll give you try to avoid saying the likelihood of the outcome is 50-50. Because business people say, that's a coin toss, folks, and I don't need an attorney to do that. If it's 50-50, I'm going to pick a course and I'm going to go because you haven't informed me at all. So try to get the kind of information that moves it a little bit off. It's a 50-50 proposition.
Okay. So legal services have obviously been changed the way they're provided to corporations over the years. And in terms of work that's done by in-house lawyers versus outside counsel, more specialization, more segmentation. I wonder if you might comment on that in terms of the way it's been and the way you think it might be going.
We've seen that too.
Yeah.
There's more differentiation, more offerings.
Oops.
More law firms. Sorry.
It's just water. We're good.
Yeah, great.
Martian.
I'll
water.
Move over
Martian
here.
Martian water.
Yeah. Thank you. And I do think, you know, I didn't get involved in that on a day-to-day basis because the executive model that I liked is we had great general counsel, and that's what I wanted our general counsel to do. But I've sure seen it. Companies will have a different composition internally. We tend to have more inside counsel than a lot of companies do. I've seen companies that have one or two or three inside attorneys, and they shop everything else out. The nature of our business is such that we don't really find that to be a valuable mechanism. But we do buy it, legal services, and sometimes we buy it by the pound. They're highly differentiated. It depends on what we want, what we think we need, what the value would be. Is it a recurring item? Is it strategic? Is it, you know, core to the company? If it's core to the company, it's strategic, we probably want to do it ourselves and not shop that out, because of the integrity and character and quality of this. I think we'll see a continual progression. I think that's true of almost everything that we see, just more highly differentiated offers. You can go to the internet and find it. And that's what we'll see in the legal shops as well.
Okay. Many of our students will go directly from law school into business or industry. Some years it's as many as one-third of our graduating class will go directly to work for a company. And I wonder if you've mentioned the fact of no legal mumbo jumbo, but I wonder if you have other advice for someone who may not actually be going to work as a lawyer at the company. Sometimes yes, sometimes no, but many of our students, unlike other law schools, are going directly to work for a company. What advice you might have for them?
Yeah, I mentioned two sons. When they went to law school, I watched them change so much for the better. They're smart guys, but the level of critical thinking they had, I thought law school was an excellent experience for them. And one is a corporate attorney and one is a special agent in the FBI, so go figure. But it was a fabulous experience because of their ability to think critically and to challenge the thinking of others and to formulate their own judgments on a basis and explain why. I really like that, and I was very proud of them for that. So I think those attributes are available to you in this education here, and you're welcome assets in a corporation, because that's where real value come from. If you're in the legal shop, get out and see the products. Meet the people who are building, in our case, spacecraft and airplanes and rockets, and go to the facilities where that's done, because that's the work of the enterprise. Sometimes attorneys have the tendency to stay with other attorneys, and I think it keeps you a little narrow, and you might find there are really exciting options maybe outside of that which is familiar to you that you would want to pursue, and we have seen spectacularly good performance from people who are recovering attorneys. And I would recommend that. And I think that's not the tendency. All kidding aside, learn about the company, learn about the board of directors, read the annual reports, read the proxies, understand what the product line is, get to know the customers are, and ask questions like, who are we and why do we believe the things we believe? Ask that question, and you'll find what truly resonates for you, and if you find that resonating frequency, you're in the right place, and because that's where passion, you hear all the time, be passionate. Be inspirational. You don't wake up in the morning and say, well, I'll go be inspirational from 9 to 10. Where's that come from? It comes from knowing, feeling connected, and this is of value, and I can make a contribution here. And that comes from getting out and making contact. So I would recommend that you do that.
Now, you mentioned that your sons went to law school and are lawyers, and I know you also have at least a daughter-in-law who's a lawyer as well. Right,
she's not a, she's not an attorney unless you know something I don't know. But two sons are.
But two sons, two for two, right?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Sounds like the next generation is getting overrun with lawyers.
Well, I don't know. I mean, the older son, who's the corporate attorney, he knew he wanted to be an attorney when he was 8. I'm not kidding you. And he knew he wanted to go to the Georgetown, which is frightening. You know, he's a kid. You don't think anything of it because he's just talking silly because he's a kid. And that's exactly what he did. The younger son wanted to be attorney, but he really couldn't express exactly why he wanted to do that. So I spent more time with the younger guy talking about, or why do you want to do it, and are you sure, just to try to get him situated. But as I said, now he's a special agent in the FBI, and he likes that work. He's in Pittsburgh hunting down bad guys, and so he's on the cyber desk in Pittsburgh. So you get real insight as to how devastating cyber crime is, and he's seeing it, the raw edge of that. I guess he's been in the job maybe 4 months now, so okay. he's a new agent, and it's fun to see the world through his eyes.
So now, as a leading business person, were you happy that your sons went to law school, or did you try to discourage them from going to law school?
I didn't try to discourage them at all, because okay. We need you. The nation's a nation of laws. And I don't want this to sound silly. You talk about justice and fairness and protecting the rights of others. What's wrong with that as a foundational dialogue to have? Not a lot of professions do that. So when you're good, you're great. And we have these complex problems. Who among you is going to be the person that figures out the international protocol for climate change? Because you're out there. It will happen. We got to have it, and it's going to come from you. And another wonderful adventures like that. So when your profession is good, it's great. When your profession is bad, it's awful. It's where all the lawyer jokes come from, right? I mean, it's just awful. So we ought to extinguish the awful part and reach for the better part. But you're indispensable. And our company would stop tomorrow if it wasn't for the quality of the legal representation and professionals that we have.
You brought up earlier your relationships with the previous leaders at Lockheed, as well as the important things that the younger generation brings to the company, which brings to mind the subject of mentoring that we hear about. And I wonder if you could just comment on more generally on mentoring and how important it is to one's career, whether that's business or law, and if you have any advice for our students about how to go about forging and maintaining a successful mentoring relationship.
Yeah, it's essential, and it should be embedded in the part of the culture and the process of every enterprise, and I'm not just talking about a business enterprise. In our case, probably in a setting a little like this, with the 300 of the senior leaders of the company, I asked the question, this was quite some time ago, how many times in your professional life has somebody like me suggested to you that part of your job is growing the next generation of leadership of this company? And not a single hand went up. Where does the leadership come from? And you can't wait until it's succession planning time and then wonder who the next person's going to be, especially as institutions get more complicated. You got to start growing leaders when their ages are in the 20s, not in the 50s. So I would recommend that you get involved, and if nobody talks to you about it, ask the question. And the funny thing about the mentoring environment is I probably learned more from the young people I was mentoring than I taught them, if that's the right way to look at it. Just, again, the view of the world, if nothing else, the use of technology, which, you know, I'm a caveman when it comes to that. And there's so much facility and so much conversation. A group of these young, we call them mentees, but these young people said, we could be more productive if we could collaborate on a kind of social media basis. Of course, you know my sentiments about social media already. But aside from the porous nature of it, when you work in classified business areas, you can't have that. So it was easy for me to tell them no. We set up a little experiment. We wrote some software. We essentially set up a little internal mechanism to do that. It was fabulous. And I thought people were going to go, like, shopping for shoes or something. You know, I mean, I didn't give it much good quality. It turns out they put up problems in thermodynamics and said across the company, anybody seen anything like this? And within 10 seconds, five responses came back. Yeah, I've done this on a rocket. I've done it on an airplane. Call me. Here's some data. Check that site out. This is a wonderful tool, right? It wouldn't have been available to our company had it not been for a group of mentees who said, we've been talking about this, and here's an idea we'd like to bring forward. So there's huge value in it. You should ask for it and expect that it'll be good for you and it'll be good for the people on the other side.
Let me switch topics. Pope Francis was here last week as part of his historic visit to the United States, and that causes me to raise a couple different topics. One is, obviously, with the Pope being a religious leader, and he met with political leaders, business leaders, and obviously the homeless as well. But I wanted to ask you, in the world of business, do faith-based values have any relevance? And if so, could you give us an example of how faith or faith-based values might have impacted your business career, or how it may have had an adverse effect on how issues are dealt with in the business world?
You know, there's a, you'll be exposed to, I think, a vocabulary in your professional lives, certainly in business and maybe particularly in publicly traded companies, where you don't use the vocabulary of spirituality a lot, mm-hmm. or faith-based. And as the chief executive officer, I got to create a climate for every employee. And you would appreciate we have some employees who are Catholics and Christians and some who are not and some who are atheists and are active in their atheism. And so the environment has a little secular tone to it. But having said that, there's nothing you will do that isn't born in part from the set of values that you take forward. And your values, at least in my case, are informed by a lot of things. And my upbringing in Western Pennsylvania, my father was a steel worker and my mom a housewife. There was a certain work ethic. I went to Catholic grade school for a while, walked to St. Pius V Church every Sunday with mom. Dad had one suit, you know, steel worker wears his one suit down to church on Sunday. I'm absolutely sure that those early discussions created a foundation of thought and respect in me that you don't separate if you're in an organization that is largely driven by secular demands. Mm-hmm. So you know what the right thing to do is, or you can figure it out. I've had to close plants. That's a terrible thing to do. But there's a question about how you might do that. So most states in the law, for the compliance side, mm-hmm. have the WARN Act provision, which means you've got to notify workers. It depends state to state, but about 90 days, I got to give you notice. But as a business executive who recognizes that the people who are impacted here, almost always through no fault of their own, mm-hmm. May need more than 90 days, I can make a decision. I can go to the board and I can say, we're going to extend benefits. We're going to help people write resumes. We're going to have an outplacement service. We're going to try to move people to other parts of the company and in absorb the relocation expense if we have work that's growing in one segment but not in another segment. You can find ways to do that if you believe that's the right thing to do. That's the fair thing to do. You could also go to the minimum and just cut it off, follow the law, the end. In the 80s, I was subjected to a lot of inconsolidation, business leaders who would take the pension funds and strip them down. I mean, it was a great source of cash rating, you know, for then it was called Raiders, and now they're Democratic shareholders. But that's what they did, took the resources out of the pension fund. We don't do that. I mean, that's wrong. And you know that's, I mean, I know that's wrong. So I think you can find a way to be, you know, effective, fulfilling your responsibilities. In the case of a CEO in a publicly traded company, you got to maximize shareholders' return over the long term. Well, over the long term is something you should think about. What character do you want the company to have? What integrity? What expectations should people have of you? And I think you can find those pathways if you work at it.
Pope has raised some concerns about the negative effects of capitalism, particularly as it may impact human dignity or as it may impact the common good. I want to ask you about your thoughts on capitalism. Do you agree with the Pope that there may be some problems with it? How do we deal with that? Is there a better system? How do we balance the profit seeking, which you need to do for the shareholders, with concerns for human dignity and the common good? And you've obviously already given an example, but just want to ask you about capitalism.
I'm a capitalist, and I'm pro-capitalism. I'm not a good authority in understanding at a macro level all the other forms. I've seen socialism and communism. I've seen some of the effects. If you've ever had the occasion to travel in Germany and you go to West Germany versus East Germany, you'll want to be in West Germany, trust me. When you see the effects of a command economy driven by the government. I've seen kleptocracies and monarchs who control the wealth. I personally think capitalism comes as close as any system I've seen to resonating to the natural frequency that people have to have a free will, to want to express that free will, to pursue an education here. The government didn't tell you to be here today. I pretty much believe that. In some countries, you wouldn't have the options you have. So I like parts of that. I do think there's an upper limit, and that's probably very subjective, where extreme behavior along any of these lines probably pushes one into an area that's very undesirable. As I said, we've tried to balance the need to generate shareholder returns with the obligation we have to employees to treat them fairly when the business circumstances turn. Now, I couldn't keep you on the payroll in perpetuity. I couldn't give you an annuity for the rest of your life, but I could try to smooth the transition over a period of time. Reasonableness is something that you could discuss. So I do think there are ways to manage an enterprise along the lines that don't completely abandon the obligation to people or respecting their dignity or helping them when the circumstances haven't aligned in a way that they would have hoped or you would have hoped, and still generate returns. I've had investors tell me they would like to see our philanthropic program stopped mm-hmm. and just give them the money. You know, the funny thing about investors, they think they own the place. They do. But I would, and I don't say this lightly, there were some discussions where I had to say you should sell the stock or do whatever you think is right, because we're not going to change this, because it's inconsistent with what we believe in and what we think generates value over the long term. And that's, again, who you want to be and how you want to behave.
Okay, let me give the audience a chance. We've been going a little over an hour, and we've got a microphone here. And if anyone has a question, please come forward or raise your hand. We'll bring the microphone to you. You've got one.
Yeah, I'm going to go ahead and answer the first question before I
okay.
toss it off.
Okay, just tell us your name and whether you're a student or a faculty member or whatever.
My name is Hans Wartenberg. I'm a student, marketing major, but I'm hoping to pursue my master's in cybersecurity policy. So my question is, what would you, or what do top-tier firms like Lockheed look for in a new hire, whether it be cybersecurity or just generally?
Yeah, there's some interesting discussions. We don't care if new employees know everything, but we sure like people who are curious, who have some track record of performance, of being exposed to things that are were uncertain to them, and they mastered that uncertainty. One of the phrases that you would hear if you were in our environment would be learning agility. You know, do people connect the dots quickly? There's a performance thing we look at. There's a behavioral thing we look at. I've met the smartest engineers. I mean, truly gifted, Nobel laureate quality engineers. When they're extroverted, they look at your shoelaces rather than theirs. And then the philosophy used to be that the best engineer becomes the engineering manager. This is a disaster, right? So we want to look for behaviors that include ethics and integrity and character, include the ability to communicate clearly. And we look for dimensions of leadership. And that doesn't mean the CEO today. I mean, I've had my colleagues lead me in the company where I was the notional head of the company. The leadership isn't about a position on the org chart. It's about the person who sees most clearly what has to be done and can rally others to that cause and get a set of outcomes, create a set of alternatives. You have to solve simultaneous equations in our part. It's got to be good for customers. It's got to be good for shareholders. It's got to be good for the employees. And we extend that a little bit and say in the communities in which we live and work, because we live and work there. And we're there for a long time. We're a 100-year-old company. So that's the kind of person that we look for. Very well-rounded, very able to get on a team. We are a team sport. If you can do those kind of things, it won't just be in our company. I guarantee you there'll be a high level of interest in people who can do those things.
Okay, good. Another question? Professor Kelly?
Hi. I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about the organization of your lawyers. Do you have them centrally at headquarters in a general counsel's office, or are they out with the divisions, and how do they communicate with each other?
Well, so the question for everybody is how do we organize our attorneys? So the general counsel is in, our corporate headquarters is in Bethesda, not far from here. People will say nothing good happens at corporate headquarters, which is probably true. Because we have a distributed architecture in the company, then a lot of the attorneys are out in the principal business area location. So there's a core group. Typically, the attorneys in corporate headquarters, if you think of a philosophy that says we'd like to centralize policy and decentralize execution, which seems to work effectively, it's a little bit of a management challenge, but if you can do that, that's a very effective model. That's the way you'd see the disposition of attorneys, the policy attorneys. The SEC attorneys, for example, would be at corporate headquarters. Some of the contract attorneys would be out where the work is really being done. So. We'll change, you know, we're not resistant to changing that if we think we need to adapt, but that model's persisted for a while and seems to be pretty effective.
Do the attorneys who are out with the division report to managers within the division, or do they report to the general counsel?
No, that's a great, it's a dual-hatted, it's a, I mean, it's not uncommon for us in the kind of programs that we're involved when to have more than one person in your chain of command. We don't want to lose the value of the fabric of being connected to other attorneys. I think that's a really important thing. And for career progress for attorneys, we don't want them to get trapped in the airplane company, and then where do I go from there? So there's an expertise issue, and I think there's a career momentum. On the other hand, some of the attorneys who went to build airplanes become program managers and other things because they like that. That's a great, some people think that's not good. We think that's great, right? Because part of this is learning about who you are, what you like. There's no prepackaged formula, and the way you know that is go out and do some things, and don't worry about screwing it up, really, because somebody's probably watching to make sure you don't really break the rocket, and you get to find the dimensions of things that you really, really like. I mentioned my younger son. He liked the idea of being an attorney a lot more than he liked the practice of law in a law firm. He was in a law firm, not a company. He likes the FBI better. It's better to go know what you want to do.
Yes, Professor Duggan.
Thanks. Hi, I'm Sarah Duggan, and I teach here. You mentioned corporate philanthropy a little bit and talked a little bit about that, and I think you specifically focused on the communities in which the company works and operates and lives. And I'm curious, though, there's been a lot of talk in recent years about strategic philanthropy and about, especially when we get to Hurricane Katrina's or tsunamis or earthquakes, about the degree to which large companies get involved with helping people, and some suggestions out of Harvard Business School and some other places that companies really should focus on this kind of notion of strategic. What are they good at, and engage in corporate philanthropy in that way? And I was just curious about your philosophy about that.
Yeah, I would say against that standard, I guess my approach was decidedly not strategic, although during Hurricane Katrina, we have a significant facility in Michoud, Louisiana, that was devastated, and the families were devastated. We couldn't even get in to see that they were okay, had no communications. Here's why trust and integrity might be worthy of some thought on your part. So with my colleagues, we concluded we need to go help these employees right now. I mean, they had nothing. So I went to the board and I asked them for $1 million that I could take, send down to Louisiana to immediately provide assistance. And then found back from the field, you couldn't wire transfer the money because there aren't any banks. There aren't any phones. So going back to the board and say, you know that $1 million? I need it in cash and I need it in small bills. You know your board trusts you when they give you $1 million in a box that we physically took, so that we could try to make distributions on the site. Here's something you don't expect. And I think this has nothing to do with me, but I think it's because when you asked early on, what are you proud of? When we put the company together, we tried to have conversations about integrity, character, ethics, who you want to be, what do you want this company to be known for. We had employees step forward and say, my kids are in college, I have 2 bedrooms, send me your 2 kids and they can stay in Texas with us or California. And employees set up the website to contribute their own money in addition to corporate money. I didn't expect that. I didn't expect that families would take in families that they didn't know and get their kids through a semester of school. I'm really proud of the people I work for. You know, we're not flawless, but so it wasn't strategic, but it was a measure of goodness.
Well, it was also still within your own company, the community you serve.
Yes.
If it's in a different area. I'm just curious because that's still within your sphere.
Yeah, I want to answer directly. That's why I say in a strategic sense, no. I mean, we'll do it within our areas of interest and responsibility, and it's almost always focused on the areas where we work.
Okay,
yeah,
thanks.
Those communities.
Okay, I think we have time for maybe one more question. Anyone else have a question? In the back there.
Uh-oh. Hi, I'm Chris Rainwater. I'm a first-year law student, and I have a question regarding the international sales or transaction of maybe defense technologies, you know, whether it be aerospace or whatever, in terms of to a foreign state, and how those work, or whether they're regulated, or you know, along those lines.
Yeah, you'd have to put a huge R on the word regulated when you talk about international sales of security-related capabilities. And there's a whole body of regulation called ITAR, International Trafficking in Arms Regulations, plus myriad other requirements that involve not just the Department of Defense, but the Department of State, and very often through the National Security Council and the White House. So it won't surprise you, perhaps, to get a sense that security cooperation partnerships are viewed as highly valuable to the leaders of our government. While the predisposition has changed, either by virtue of parties or time, it's good to have partners around the world, and it's good to have those partners have the ability to defend and protect themselves as well as American interests. Therefore, people like me get encouraged to reach out. Part of the Russian illustration I gave you in buying a, I wouldn't have found my way to Moscow to buy a rocket motor were it not for the encouragement of our government to do so. So we have and everything has to be approved all the way through the Congress. So we're not Starbucks. You know, when you ask somebody in our company, are we a global business? They'll want to tell you yes, because we're in 47 countries, but we're not a global business. Because the behavior in a global business, if you're Starbucks, is you go down and open up a store on a corner. We don't go sell somebody an F-16. We've got to go through the government and everything. Not only are the products approved, our ability to have a conversation with somebody has to be approved in advance. So it's probably one of the most highly regulated, highly disciplined environments ever. From my point of view, appropriately so. You don't want this stuff getting into the wrong hands.
All right, why don't we stop there? I thank all of you for your attention and for coming today. I think we've all benefited from Mr. Stevens' keen insights. Please join me in thanking Mr. Stevens.
Thank you very much.
I also want to say a special word of thanks to Father O'Brien, who taught one of Mr. Stevens' sons, and from that relationship introduced us to Mr. Stevens and encouraged him to come today. You're all invited to join us outside in the atrium for a reception and have an opportunity to meet Mr. Stevens in person. Thank you.
Thanks, Steve. Thank you.
Thanks so much.